We wouldn't
start with the hair.
The hair's supposed to be down here.
Deborah and I became best friends in the third grade. We had, we sat across from each other, Trice across from Turner, and she was always the most beautiful kid in the class, and she had this laugh that was like twice her size, happy, and we became best friends.
And you loved dinosaurs.
Yeah.
You were the only little girl I knew who could name
still
all
like
the
dinosaurs.
Period. You still like
yes.
dinosaurs?
Yes. Did you see King Kong? Did you see those scenes?
What was the attraction with dinosaurs?
I love them.
We grew up in Theodore K. Lawless Gardens apartment complex. There were many times when we would just kind of run up and down this little sidewalk going from place to place. This is where the roots are. It wasn't quite solidly middle class, but it wasn't also the housing projects that were just to the east. So you had two kids who were very much starting out on the same path. And I mean, we were going to be doctors, and we were going to, I mean, these two little girls making up this story of our future. And in 1979, her family moved, left Chicago, and moved to Indianapolis. But in Indianapolis, her life really started to take a turn. She got 50 years for murder. She murdered a man with whom she was doing crack years ago. And they had spent an afternoon getting high in her mother's house, and they went their separate ways. And then when her mom came home, she found that jewelry was missing, and Deborah set out to get her mother's jewelry back, and met up with this man in front of his house, and there was some talk about the jewelry, and she had a gun with her. And the gun went off, she fired the gun, and it shot him in his heart. And he died on the sidewalk in front of his house.
131425.
From day one, I've never denied that I was guilty of something, you know? The only thing I don't want people looking at me is I'm not a murderer, mm-hmm. Okay? The charge is murder. I'm not a murderer. I would rather have a reckless homicide, you know, something like that. I would rather have that than murder, you know, mm-hmm. on there, because when people hear the word murder, you know, you think of the Psycho movie, you know, they, no, you know. I've accepted. I think I need to do my time, you know, for society, for the family, you know, for me, for God, you know, I made a mistake. I made a horrible mistake, and it caused a lot of pain, you know, for my family, for his mother, you know, that caused a lot of pain. And sometimes it trips me out to know that I'm responsible for something like that, you know, because of the way I am. I'm not a mean-spirited person, you know, I never have been. You know, at one time I wanted to be a nurse, you know, to help people.
Deborah was one of those people who would experiment with a lot of different things, right? So, I mean, so she did a lot of experimenting. And I do think that she probably got caught up in crack in a way that she just didn't understand just how tough it was to disentangle herself from.
My drug use, I had just about given up trying to get off. Actually, I did give up trying to get off of drugs. I was suicidal because I couldn't believe I had sunk to that level. I couldn't get off of them. I went in my mom's car and went out in the garage and closed myself in there and turned the ignition on. Well, I decided if I couldn't go out that way, that I would just live empty, you know, because I didn't want to be here anymore, because I didn't like the person in the mirror. I didn't like myself. You know, I couldn't hold a job anymore. I had just lost everything. And I just couldn't, I didn't want to be here. I mean, there's just no other way to put it. I did not want to be here. And I made a deal with God. I said, you know what, if you want me to be a dope addict, you know, I'm going to be the best one. And from that day forward, I made an effort to do drugs every day. That was my goal.
One of the most striking things about our discussions was talking about the victim's mom and how the mom had forgiven her.
And back here she said, please don't hurt yourself. She said, your mother and sister, their hearts hurt. She said, they love you very much. Show them you are strong, not for yourself, but for them. And then she said she would keep in touch, and she kept in touch all the way up until
she died.
Yeah.
There were years when we would talk either on the phone or we would write letters, and I'd read her stuff going, you know, she may not be on drugs, but she still hasn't extricated herself from that mindset.
It just led to so much awakening, mm-hmm. You know, how fragile life is, for one, mm-hmm. How quick things could change just like that. And I know people say this all the time, but to actually live that, you'd never know. That is the honest to God truth. Your whole life can change in one flash. And lots of people's lives, his family, mm-hmm. You know, his children, you know.
And now I think I talk to her, and I mean, I see a person who reminds me of that little girl that I sat across the desk from. And it's amazing to have watched her journey. You know, we could talk about drugs and telling people, you know, telling kids not to do drugs. But she said that her father was very clear and adamant about both of his daughters not using drugs. So it didn't resonate with her. I don't pretend to, you know, be on the soapbox and saying, you know, this is what we should and shouldn't do. I just, like, here's a story. Here's somebody who just really fell off the path, and now she's struggling to get back on. You know, you don't necessarily have to follow go that same route. And maybe that's what she's hoping to tell young people, that, you know, if you have a choice, if the road bifurcates, then, you know, really stand there. If you have to stand there for a few extra minutes to decide not to go down that other road, then maybe it's worth the time.